much and see snow. So this is kind of weird for me. But it's just great to be back here. It is also great to be here at JV College. Very great to be around the school from Thierry. But I have a special place in my heart for community colleges because I started out with Thierry Community College at Orange Coast College. And actually on the way here we were talking, I had more fun and I learned more at OCC than at Irvine where I finished my degree, my undergraduate degree. And so you guys should also consider yourself lucky that you're here, and don't let anybody ever make you feel like this is less important than the four-year colleges. So I just want to say that and get it out of the way, because it's always been something that I've carried with me, and I've talked to my students. I teach, I'm an adjunct professor of business at George Washington University as well. And I teach both undergrad and graduate students. And so I've had the opportunity, and I've also taught abroad. And I've always said the best place for me, where I, you know, compared to all these institutions where I spend time, where there's no place that would equal to my time where I spent my time at Orange Coast College. I don't know, maybe it's something about Orange Coast College, but the experience was wonderful. And also, it wasn't just the university, but the people I met at the university were fantastic. I mean, at OCC. Alright. So, my name is Yohannes Assefa. Terry is spreading lies about me with that flyer. So, sometimes don't believe what he says. I'm originally from Ethiopia. I came here when I was a teenager in Southern California to Huntington Beach. I went to high school at Huntington Beach High. So I went to then OCC, UCI, then went to the Midwest, did my master's at Indiana State, and then eventually law school at Northeastern University in Boston. And in between, I did various things. Practiced law in New York, mostly. Practiced law in general for about 8 years at two large law firms. One, a Wall Street firm called Hawkins de la Filbin Whitt, a financial sector law firm that specialized in securities. I'm a securities lawyer. If you put me in a box, I did a lot of stuff, so it's really hard to describe what I am, but that's where I started in my practice and worked mostly on financial transactions, mergers and acquisitions, bonds, derivatives, securities, and lendings, and working with banks, and sovereign lendings, and many more things. The sum of that experience, for me, was looking at the market as a whole, as a system, because I worked from one end to the other. I started out as a young lawyer, first clerking at the New York Supreme Court, Appellate Division in Rochester. And then that sort of gave me a bird's eye view about how litigation works and how financial transactions are litigated. Then went into work into the actual transactions, starting out as a young lawyer, working on simple transactions, you know, neighborhood, simple LLC formations to eventually more complex transactions. But eventually, everything for me as a securities lawyer revolved around the market, right? Whether you're going to market or you're always considering the market's sort of impact on the transaction you work. In 2006, I moved to DC to work at another law firm. I spent 2 years. That brought me closer to the international market. Ironically, I thought I would be closer to the international market in New York, but in DC, I had an opportunity to interact with the international market. Eventually, during the financial crisis, I had been offered a job. I'm giving you this little context so you'll have a better understanding of what I do and why I do it, and also some of my perspectives or opinions. When the financial sector, well, there was a meltdown, you know, there was this job offer I had from USAID, the U.S. Agency for International Development, the U.S. government's primary development agency for international development. To go back to my birth country, Ethiopia helped establish a commodities exchange, an agricultural market. I've never worked on an agricultural market, but I've worked on derivatives. The NYMEX, the New York Mercantile Exchange, and CBOT in Chicago, not directly on the market, but on products that go into the market. So I accepted that job. It was sort of radical for me. I've lived here since I was 16, and now my mid-30s, after so many years, I just barely recognize the place, but I still have family connections and decided to jump and go. And I don't know if I would have done it if it wasn't for the financial crisis. I was just getting tired of the system, But there, my experience changed my life. One, going back to my roots, right, reconnecting with the country of my birth. Two, working with poor people, farmers, smallholder farmers. You know, when we talk about financial markets, we never think of, especially on the agricultural commodity exchanges or derivative markets, even though the underlying assets were the, derivative, but essentially the word is you're deriving some value from an underlying asset. And in the agricultural derivative markets, you're essentially securitizing the sack of maize that would be converted into a securities instrument, right? So into contracts. And those contracts are what are traded on the market, either in the futures or in spot on a daily basis. And so, but we forget that the starting point are farmers, whether here in the US, in Iowa, corn farmers, or, pork belly is traded. The pork belly that comes from the farms in Iowa. I'm thinking Iowa because Iowa's in the news today. That less important thing going on there. But going back to Ethiopia, poor farmers trying to survive, these are farmers who eke out, barely enough to live on, but they have a little bit more to sell and generate more income. The idea was, and with all the development agencies, was trying to see if there's a structured market to allow for greater efficiency in the marketplace. And with that, be able to allow the farmers to earn more, right? Take some of the middlemen out of the process, but also put rules, structures, meaning farmers are not cheated, or at least cheated less, because cheating will always be there. I can tell you this, there's no way to eliminate cheating. And then create efficiency whereby there's more value, and you also provide information. Markets are all about information, access to information, so allowing farmers to have better information would allow them to negotiate better, right? You give them better bargaining power. So that led to the creation of the Ethiopia Commodity Exchange, which I'm happy to say now, after 7 years, they're doing in their annual transaction, an aggregate is over $2.5 billion. So we got started from the start. It's nothing. We showed up at a warehouse, right? We had to put in the laws, the regulations, the funding, training people, creating contracts, creating the systems, teaching, educating, and all that stuff. So that's where I started. Then from there on, went on to found a company with colleagues and based in Dubai, and we've been trying to replicate similar models across Africa and South Asia. In South Asia, mostly India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Nepal. So this is a similar sort of markets. India has a very sophisticated commodities exchange, derivatives market, but there's more work, there's more expansion. In Africa, I worked in 12 countries over the last 4 years on developing these markets. And not all of them end up being a very sophisticated derivatives or spot market, but there are steps in between to create these markets. And so that's what I've been working on. I want to give you sort of a perspective on Africa, because it's really important. What you get from the news media and what you see, read about, always doesn't give you the big picture. So I have a few slides that I usually use for these kinds of discussions. And this is one of them. So Africa is big. You know, people don't think about it. It's a continent, 54 countries. And in the landmass, look at it, the United States, Argentina, Western Europe, China, India, all combined, they still have more space. So the physical mass of the continent is huge, right? Over a billion people. The narrative over the last few years, the narrative over the last 40 years have been Africa's war, hunger, you know, all kinds of ugly stuff, disease, Ebola, that's what you hear. It's true. But the last 20 years, things have changed, especially the last 10 years. Africa has become the last frontier for investment and for business. It's become greatly democratized. There are more democracies now in Africa than there were in the past. Fewer wars and strifes. There's still a lot of problems. Africa is still very poor. But there's been a rise also in sophistication of the market and also income and wealth. Not many people associate Africa with wealth, but Africa is now one of the sources of the world's wealth. A lot of companies around the world are rushing to capitalize on this. Americans are always a little slow, partly because the American economy has been resilient, even when it's down, has looked to the sort of the less riskier markets, like in Asia and South America. But even American companies can't resist. This week, I was supposed to be in Addis Ababa. There's a big meeting called CCA, the Corporate Council on Africa, is one of the oldest trade associations of American companies doing business in Africa. They're doing a huge conference there, and they're taking, I think, over 200 major companies to meet and discuss about business opportunities. So among all the bad news, there's some good news, right? So that's what's happening. And looking at sort of the numbers, there are 20 companies, African-based indigenous companies, with over $3 billion in revenue, right? If they weren't here, they would be in Fortune 500. I mean, these are indigenous companies started by Africans and operating in Africa. That's big business. Foreign direct investment is $72 billion annually. That's as much as what flows into China on a good year. In the last couple of years, China is having trouble. And more and more. The combined economy of Africa is about 1.6 trillion, and this is a few years old. This is probably over 2 trillion right now. How is this happening? All of it, not all of it, most of it is driven by resources, right? Oil, minerals. But growingly, increasingly, agriculture has become a very important export and part of business. And the third and emerging market area is technology. Believe it or not, Africa is exporting technology to the world right now. Africa is leading the way in terms of, for example, mobile technology. We're just beginning to use Apple Pay. You know, people are excited, oh, Apple Pay in Africa. They've been using wired mobile-based payment systems for the last 20 years. Guess what? Makes sense, right? They're leapfrogging sort of the technology innovations because trying to catch up using the same route that the West has gone through is expensive. It takes time. Now you have mobile technology where you don't need fixed lines, right? You don't, banking services are not readily available or not deeply available, so you use mobiles to come up with banking services. You have e-wallets where you transfer used credits. You convert airtime credits into money. So there's all kinds of innovations that's happening. That's not even here yet. It is driving innovation and efficiency in the marketplace in Africa. So there are creative industries and technology that's come up. I just came from the Silicon Valley where I spoke on investing in Africa. There were a lot of private equity firms. and there's a huge amount of interest now from the PE firms in the Silicon Valley in investing in the technology sector in Africa. Kenya and Nigeria, South Africa, the leading areas in Kenya, they call this Silicon Savannah. There's a whole range of young entrepreneurs who founded startups that are doing really well. All right, so I mentioned a little bit about this sort of narrative that exists. Taking Thierry's favorite magazine, The Economist. Economist is one of the most important business magazines in the world. They're a little conservative in their outlook, but they're always very good at taking the issues, breaking down, and analyzing. But they've also missed trends, like everybody else, like all of us. So following their assessment of Africa has always been interesting, and they're also British, so the Brits have been in Africa, they have long-standing interests, so they know Africa very well, but they also have their prejudices. So you see all of it in here. And so, in the past, it was the hopeless continent, right? War, civil war, hunger, famine, disease. Right? Then the next stage is Africa rising. Things are happening, good things are coming up. Then aspiring Africa, that's the future. It's no longer about survival. Africa rising is, we're no longer dealing with the past, the war, the famine. Now we have hope. Africa rising is things are happening, good are going in the right direction. Aspiring is what I was saying, building technologies, new things coming out of Africa that people don't think about. So I always use this and it gets a lot of interesting comments. All right, so Africa today, I mentioned some of these points earlier. More than today, I think that tomorrow is more interesting to me. By 2020, the collective GDP would be 2.6 trillion. It's a lot of money. Also, another very important point, discretionary incomes and household income growing. This has led to the PNGs of the world rushing to Africa, no longer just exporting stuff that was made in China. They are now building plants in individual countries and manufacturing soaps and fast-moving consumer products to sell to African households and consumers. Because now, African middle class is growing and they have disposable income to spend, right? And buy American products or foreign products. But they have to now compete with the early movers, like the Europeans, and even locally started manufacturers. So some of the American companies are playing catch up, and they're trying to catch up either by investing or buying into the market. Right? That's the cost of being late. This is another economist fun fact. Top growers from 2001 to 2010, right? Top 10? Out of the top 10, 6 are from Africa. Number 1 being Angola. It's all driven by oil. Angola is an oil-based economy, 11.1%. Nigeria. Now, this is interesting. Ethiopia. The first time I saw it, I was confused because Ethiopia doesn't have a drop of oil, or resources for that matter. Or Rwanda for that matter. Right? But Mozambique is oil, Chad is oil, Nigeria, Angola, all these are oil-based economies. The story of Ethiopia and Rwanda is the story of the future of Africa. Their economies are agrarian, it's all based on improvements in efficiency and agricultural development. Right, new technologies, investments in infrastructure, right, educational improvements, MDG goals, the Millennium Development Goals, reaching healthcare to rural families and poor families, all in aggregate is leapfrogging these countries into the next level of development. talk brewers from 2010 to 2015. This was supposed to be kind of forward-looking. Again, China is a top. This would be a revised in 2016. China is struggling. But look, number three in the world, Ethiopia again. Yeah, Mozambique and Tanzania. Tanzania is also agrarian. But you have Congo, the DRC, which is a basket case. They don't have a functioning government, you know? Barely functions, but the economy is growing. How do you explain that? There's a lot of interest. There's a lot of money coming out of it. And it's not all resources. Agriculture. Ghana, again. Ghana is a small country, 25 million people. It's mostly agrarian. But their technology sector, their industrial base is expanding. Where is the growth? Here. Consumer resources, agriculture, infrastructure. Okay, commodity prices have been good until recently, but the last couple of years, commodity prices have crashed, partly because of the slowdown in China, which is the biggest consumer of commodities. These are net agricultural commodities I'm talking about. But even agricultural commodities, China is a big buyer. For example, about 50% of China's sesame import comes from Ethiopia, just one country. So if Chinese economy slows down, you know, Ethiopian economy is going to slow down because they have to find another market, or that all that sesame is going to go somewhere. Remittance. Those are money that being sent back home by immigrants from the diaspora. They're billions and billions of dollars are being sent back. That's another important driving force. African food market. And these are prospective areas for investment that people are looking at. If you're looking at investing, if I want to invest in Africa, where should I look at? And these are some of the sectors that are doing really well. Almost all of them are tied to agriculture. Again, think about the first slide. Africa has something like one-third of the world's arable land, right? And most of them are virgin land, not touched yet. There are challenges with climate change and various things. El Nino this year is affecting weather patterns in Africa, the droughts, and so there are huge challenges going in. But the challenges are also becoming an opportunity. So American companies who are really known for dry farming are providing solutions from Idaho and other places to African commercial farmers on how to cope with El Nino-related weather challenges in producing important commercial crops. So one man's misery is another man's opportunity. Well, I'm going to skip through some of this. I'll be happy to give to Terry the slides, so you'll have an opportunity to look at it closely, or feel free to ask me questions. Let me take a couple of countries and just zoom in to give you a closer look. Again, Africa is a continent of big 54 countries. A lot of times in the media, you may hear Africa almost as one country, right, in the narrative when people talk about it. But each country is very different. Ethiopia. I just revised the population numbers last night. There's a new CIA fact book online, revision and the estimate of the population. 99 million. I think when I left Ethiopia as a 16-year-old kid, population was like 55 million, so it was almost doubled. 76 million hectares of arable land. Again, Mozambique, 25 million population, 37 million arable land. Tanzania, 45 million population, 44 million arable land. And so there's also large groups of investors coming and taking land. It's 80,000 hectares taken by investors in Tanzania, 1.3 million hectares in Mozambique, and 3.6 million in Ethiopia. That's going to drive a huge change in Africa and in the world in terms of food prices, because food prices have been growing, right, going up over the last 10 years. That is spawning the investment in these lands in Africa. Some of these big investors are sovereign funds from the Middle East. They have money, but they don't have arable land. The oil is going to run out sometime. So they have to lock in a process for the future for a good, reliable supply of food. Right? One way to do it is invest in large commercial farms in Africa. Now, there have been some problems with these deals, right? So there's some land grabbing issues, partly because some of the governments, the institutional capacity of the governments are not strong enough to properly negotiate and manage these contracts. But there have been also lessons from the early mistakes, and despite what you hear, in large part, the recent experience has been positive in the large commercial investments. And some of the countries now require that a certain percentage of the product the production has to be locally sold. They cannot all 100% export everything back to their whatever market they're exporting. So this is not only meeting their local food security demands, but is also making food available worldwide. And most of this is organic farming, partly because modern farming using chemicals is very expensive in Africa because you don't have the manufacturers and the suppliers locally. You have to import it from somewhere. It makes it more expensive. So this process has forced investors and local farming communities to come up with creative, environmentally friendly farming methods. There's still some farming, you know, using some pesticides and chemicals, but overwhelmingly the process has been using organic compost and looking at local varieties to grow and come up with cost-effective methods of growing organic food. The challenge in this process has been the certification process. The certifications are really control in the US and in Europe where the markets are, and the certification costs are really high. And sometimes it's very difficult for farmers to go through the certification process and get that organic certification. There's a mafia involved in that process. Okay. All right. This is my favorite picture. It tells the story of Africa. Right? You're only seeing the tip of the iceberg. There are going to be continuing challenges. There are going to be continuing hiccups. But the future is bright and it's irreversible. And that's sort of the broad picture I want you to take with you when you leave from today, from this talk. There are a lot of facts, a lot of data. People will say, oh, what if this was, you know, this happened in this country, this happened. These are temporary setbacks. These, by the way, all this stuff happened in Asia too. Asia had their, you know, their murders, their hungers, and dictators, and, you know, fun for me is to go back and look at what was going through. In 1960 or something, believe it or not, Ethiopia sent food aid to South Korea. Now the South Korean sent food aid to Ethiopia, right? This is weird. Like for me to go back and look at, wow, you know, Ethiopia's economy was bigger than Vietnam's in 1983, in the middle of the civil war. But look where Vietnam is. But these Asian countries have been able to come out of that. Why not Africa? Right? But the process is happening. Because there is also financial and political interest in the stability and prosperity of Africa for the whole world. The more stable and prosper is Africa, it's better for the rest of the world. So that common understanding and interest is also driving developments on the continent. All right, so The continuing challenges include continuing problems for people like me traveling and doing business. As I said, I worked in 12 countries for the last 4 years. And the fun part has been for me to go to a new country, learn about the culture, the business environment, and also to get involved at early stages, you know, in business opportunities. Some of the stuff I do, I mean, the two categories that I work on, or we work on in our company, one is capital market development, the second is capital formation. So at the capital market development, we're working building agricultural commodity markets, the derivative markets. We also work with equity markets, right? Many African countries have stock exchanges, but they're really underutilized and they're still developing. So we get involved to help them expand their market. And the second part is capital formation. Excuse me. The capital formation part is working with entrepreneurs, either negotiate investments for foreign direct investments or working with foreign investors and helping them mitigate their risk and find a better way to invest in companies on the continent. So I clock a lot of miles. Last year I was in Africa 16 times. That's over, you know, more than once a month. Sometimes I'm there 3 times a month. My family's in DC, so I'm obligated to keep going back and forth. But there's a lot of stuff that happens. I'm learning. I mean, every day is a learning experience for me. Now, I may go as an expert, as an advisor, but I always feel like I come out learning more than what I left, you know, for the people I work with. And that's the fun part, right? So continuing to learn about what's happening. And what I learn from one country, I use in another country. And what I learn from another, you know, it keeps on. And then the sum total is what makes this whole process really exciting and interesting. But, you know, Thierry wanted me to talk about a couple of things that happened along the way, you know, which reminds me Africa is still developing and Africa is Africa. And one of the things that happened to me last year was I was doing work in Burkina Faso. How many of you know where Burkina Faso is? Of course you do. Well, it used to be called Upper Volta. Right? It's a former French colony just north of Ghana. It's a Sahelian country, meaning it's on the edges of the Sahara Desert. Very interesting country with long independent history until the French really forced them into a submission. They fought the French hard. They were independent until the turn of the century. I think they were colonized like in 1902 or something. They resisted for a long, long time. They're old feudal society. Very interesting economy, very interesting country. And I was working with the government there through a Gates Foundation project to help them come up with a national strategy for agricultural marketing, right? To come up with a structured trading system. And I had been there a couple of times, and this last year, the second trip I went to was to present to a national committee of experts on the findings of our study. Halfway through the process, I was staying in a hotel right next to the parliament. This really gives you sort of an example of Africa's transition. And I've been reading about the country. I always do when I go to one country. I try to study and understand what's going on in the country, just for my own interest. And at that time, the president of the country, Blaise Compaoré, had been in power for 27 years. Right? He took over from Thomas Sankara. I don't know how many of you know Thomas Sankara. I'm sure you've heard the word Sankara somewhere. Thomas Sankara was a revolutionary leader, took power in the 80s. He had this really amazing ideas about Pan-Africanism, about development, fighting corruption. But 4 years into his power, he shook really the power structures, and he was very egalitarian. He was very much the people's man, wanted to help the poor farmers. His life was cut short under mysterious circumstances. The allegation was that his lieutenant, which became the president, was involved in his death. So this guy has been in power for 27 years, like the last 8 being elected in an African democracy, right? but wanted to run for a third term. The Constitution said, you know, there's a term limit, 2 terms, that's it. But wanted to convince Parliament to allow him to run for a third term, and people were adamant. People were, you know, pro-democracy advocates were on the street, shouting and yelling, no more, right? Give a chance to other leaders. But this guy and his family were very powerful, had strong business interests, had bought some of the parliamentarians financially, bribing in other ways, and had logged in the votes. But the people said, we're gonna stop the parliamentarians from going into parliament. We're gonna really stand, you know, in front of the parliament and not, you know, force the parliamentarians not to vote. Because we know they've been bought. Well, unfortunately for me, my hotel is right next to parliament. Right? So I have a bird's eye view of all this happening. I was just praying, you know, finish my work and just get out before all this happened, before they elect, I mean, the votes. Well, not really. We, you know, the whole area was surrounded and protected by the National Army, not the police, because they thought, you know, so it was important. And they were trying to be smart, so they snuck in the parliamentarians into my hotel, right? The night before, so they can put them into the parliament through the back door. Well, people found out, and the radios went off, you know. So the next day, demonstrators went out, you know, just it was pandemonium, it was crazy. And what was interesting was the military also melted away. Some in the military sympathized with the people. What happened was the people came to my hotel, ransacked my hotel, burned it down to the ground. yeah, so the U.S. Embassy was on lockdown and nobody came to the rescue. It was me and a few other Americans staying at the hotel. We were rescued by the French military. Everybody's afraid of the French military there. So since the French showed up, the kids ran away. But I'm gonna show you a video. Just the perils of working internationally. I'm not trying to scare you. But now, I mean, the good story about this, I mean, finally, is that they had a transitional government after that. The president ran away, he's in exile, and they had an election, purely democratic election process. So they have a democratic elected president and parliament right now, and the country is back to normal. But unfortunately, a few weeks ago, they had a terrorist attack, right? Al-Qaeda and the Maghreb took over a hotel, a hotel that I stayed in, some of my colleagues stayed in the past, and killed some people. So it's unfortunate that they're still experiencing some problems. All right, this is from my hotel room. Like bird's eye view. You can hear the demonstrators outside. And this is the hotel. I'm on the second floor, all surrounded by demonstrators. Kind of really shady, you know. You can understand. Anyway, I stayed at this hotel because I don't usually stay at the big fancy tourist hotels or foreigners. No, the hotels where foreigners usually stay. I like to blend in. I like to go to the local nice hotels, right, and deal with the local business people. But this one was right in the middle of the business district, and it was considered safe, and because of all that was happening, it would be well protected. That was the idea. It sure was well protected until it wasn't. This was the car one of the parliamentarians aligned with the president. By the way, all throughout this process, I was tweeting. And what's interesting is, you know, we were trying to get the U.S. Embassy to respond. Even the French consulate, you know, once we were taken to the French consulate got on the phone, and the American embassy said, oh, okay, let's think about it, we're figuring out something. And then it went on, like, the French consulate called them like 3 times. By the third hour, they said, I'm sorry, your people are not coming yet. But I've been tweeting all through the process, and colleagues at the State Department saw the tweets and got on the phone to the embassy and get on their case. And eventually they responded, they called us and they apologized, but it was too late. And I really, at that point, I didn't want to talk to anybody. I was pissed.
What year was that?
Last year. These are young people who are fed up. I mean, these are millennials, right? These are young people who have grown up in this new environment of the internet age. They have access to what's going on elsewhere in the world. They want the same life as people elsewhere. They want democracy, they want rights.
And what city is this?
This is in, I forgot the name, sorry, headline. This is the capital of Burkina Faso. Oh, Ouagadougou. Or in short, they call it Ouaga. Ouagadougou. Yeah.
I'll put it on Moodle, don't worry.
Actually, I can spell it. It's they use the French spelling. By the way, that chopper is not the news media. It's the military. And this is the parliament. See that? That's parliament. This is my hotel, right? That's parliament. Alright, this does not flow. It's the first and the last time it happened. Alright, I think you can see enough. I got more, but I'll save it. Alright, let me give you a chance. The fun part for me is to interact and, you know, answer questions. I've said enough. So let me know if you have any questions.
Did you say they burned your hotel room too?
Yeah.
And you were you?
Oh, so while this was happening, you know, something like half an hour later, the French came in and rescued us. You know, luckily I speak enough French to know what was going on. I was listening to the radio, listening to people in the hallways. So when the cavalry came, you know, they said, come out, you know, we're taking people. And there were 20 of us who were like foreign nationals. They packed us up in a van and took us to the French consulate, which was actually 2 blocks down. It was really sad what happened. I mean, they tore down that hotel. The next day, it was only walls. You know, it was crazy. It was absolutely crazy. I went back. I mean, the next day, everything was peaceful. They were really nice people. I mean, there was just a lot of pent-up anger, and they were getting their anger. After 27 years of what was going on in that country, I would have been, if I was one of them, I would have been out there doing what they were doing.
They were afraid that the guy would get another term. So
he was going to, if they didn't do this. Okay. You know, people took power to their hands. This is vigilantism to the highest level.
Did you say, I heard you speak about derivatives very briefly. Did you say that you set up a derivative market in Ethiopia?
And yeah.
If so, I know that was a big deal in our 2008 financial collapse, derivative market. lack of regulation. Is there any safeguards that you set up in Ethiopia to prevent what happened in this country?
Good question. So what happened here really had very little to do with the agricultural or commodity derivatives market. It was more with the
oil and housing, right?
Housing, mostly driven by housing, right? So mortgage-backed securities, the CDOs, which, you know, I'm partly to blame. I worked on some of those. It's essentially what happens is, you know, when you get a mortgage, the bank that's issuing your mortgage sells that mortgage to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. There's guidelines, if it meets that guidelines, right? The guidelines are to make sure they're tradable, right? They package them together, and they chunk them together, and they create what they call asset-backed securities. And that security is traded again on the financial markets to investors. And then the investors also trade it. There's a lot of loops involved. And then there's interest swaps at the interest rate that's traded. And, you know, it gets more complicated. But some of the underlying issues, because the mortgages themselves were not investment worthy, right? So when people come,
they were overinflated.
Yeah, they were inflated. Some people who shouldn't get loans were getting loans. And then when they stop paying, there's a foreclosure. And there's no revenue coming from these mortgages, which were supposed to pay the interest on these securities, right? There are people, there's a, what we call interest stack. In the interest stack, you may have 8% or whatever, and there may be like five different investor groups taking a percent or half a percent, whatever, at different levels of securities, right? So when the revenue dries up, the whole structure collapses, right? But somebody has to pay for it. And so the sum of that, just in general, this rosy picture that all these people are going to pay, and is what led to the, but that had a knock-on effect, you know, on the financial sector globally, and that affected everything. I worked on housing mortgages, I mean housing bonds, like for example, low-income housing bonds. These are government-sponsored financing schemes, right, to help build, for builders, to build low-income housing, hospitals, schools, bridges, you know, all kinds. Terry,
Real quick, could you let us know a little bit about the coffee trade before, during, and after
Absolutely.
You came in Ethiopia specifically, and fair trade as well. What fair trade does to the coffee trade in Ethiopia today?
Okay, so let's finish your. You know, I need to go back and answer your primary question. Yes, the regulatory structure is set. We help set up a regulatory institution, we help train the regulators, we put in the right legal regulatory mechanisms, but also the structure of the market is delivery based. So in the derivatives market, the US derivative market is only 3% of the contracts are actually delivered. You're actually speculating on futures contracts that may never get delivered. You take a position, you square it off, you take options, they're way. But you know, you park your money, you're hedging on another product or something. So it's used for financial risk management, more so, right? But in the agricultural derivatives, and the old-fashioned Chicago Board of Trade system was, you know, I have contracts I want to sell. I'm selling corn from Iowa, Idaho, whatever it is, grain. And it's at someone's warehouse. I have a contract that a warehouse receipt I'm trading. I buy, I take that warehouse receipt, I take the delivery. That's what we did in Africa. Right, that's what we did in theory. So there's less of, so we take some of the speculative stuff out of it. There's still speculation. There's good and bad speculation, by the way. I'm not opposed to speculation. Speculation is good when it's centered on some, you know, reality. So going back to the coffee issue, coffee is the biggest commodity traded on the exchange that we worked on. Before the exchange, there were these pseudo auctions regulated by the government, but there were a lot of games, right? So the exporters are the most business savvy and sophisticated in the country. These are people who buy from aggregators, who buy from the farmers. The exporters export to the world market, to the Starbucks of the world. Usually they have the financial means, they're sophisticated, they have access to international market price. Coffee is traded in New York. The reference market is the New York C market contract on NYMEX that determines the base price for Arabica coffee in the world. And so these guys on their phone have access to the daily prices, and then they determine what price they should use to buy, and they were virtually integrated as well in the supply chain. So they put, normally prices were, you know, the major coffee trading centers are London and Geneva, and in Geneva and London people will set the prices, and then they work backwards to the farm gate price, and farmers, instead of being price makers, they were price takers, right? They were forced to take these prices, and they have no other alternatives. With this rearrangement of the market, right, new structures, new regulatory process, and a transparent trading system allowed the farmers, one, to have equal access to market information, because we built market data system with the World Bank support in every market village where coffee was grown and traded. So the farmers will have first-hand experience knowing the daily prices, right, how much their coffee was. They could do the deductive sort of understanding how much their farm gate price would be. And so that gave them power. Also allowed the aggregators, who used to be beat up by the exporters who had financial power, to say, oh, no, I'm not selling. This is not the price that I want. Because on the trading platform, right, it's monitored. Their rules on, I mean, if somebody doesn't want to sell, they don't have to sell. No one could force them to sell. That created another bargaining process and forced the international buyers and their local agents, the exporters, to deal with on a transparent basis with the marketplace. So that created a fair price discovery mechanism. So the price of a product should be what the buyer and seller are willing to pay for it, right? Supply and demand. When you have, when the market is not manipulated, you get a sort of, the market determines the price of the product. So you take in all the information, the fair market price hypothesis, I don't know if you guys go through this. And eventually the market determines what the price of that, that's how stocks are traded, the stock market. But you have to have all these regulations. You have to make sure there's no insider trading. That insider trading also exists in commodity exchanges. But when you have all that transparency pricing, you get a better price and efficiency in the marketplace and better distribution. Not fair distribution, better distribution of the wealth that comes out of the underlying commodity. So farmers over the last 8 years have incrementally earned more money from their coffee than they did before the exchange was built. But the country as a whole has also earned more money from the export of better quality of coffee, because now there's an elasticity of pricing, there's a better pricing response to quality. Before, the farmer, whether the farmer produces quality or not, he gets one price, right? Whatever the buyer thinks is the price. But producing quality has a premium. Right? If you want to produce quality coffee, you have to take care of the tree. You can only pick the right cherry, right color of cherry, right, at the right time of the year. You have to do it the right way. You have to put it, pack it, you put it in the right bag, in the right storage. That is premium, right? It costs the farmer more to do that. But if he's getting crappy prices, he has no incentive to do that. But when he's getting better prices, he has an incentive to get, because now there's also quality determination, not arbitrary, but objective pricing and the quality determination process. Right? Someone else, an independent third party, tells them, the buyer and seller, what the quality is. Right? Not the traders determining the quality. So that led to, actually, we had the Coffee Quality Institute of America come and do blind tests on the quality process. And what they found was the top two grades of quality in 2 years jumped from something like less than 10% of the overall production of coffee in the country to a third of that. So in 2 or 3 years, the quality coffee produced by farmers jumped by a third, which meant that you get better prices in the international market. The country is exporting more. And so overall, across the board, you get better benefits from the system. In terms of fair trade, I'm not a big fan of fair trade, because fair trade is more of a business, right? So in reality, what happens is there's an association called Fair Trade America, but it's a global organization as well, that they have the process to be certified as fair trade. You're supposed to meet certain standards, and then that coffee or product you're selling is supposed to earn better And studies, there have been many studies that have shown the farmers have not really received much. Usually the traders are the ones who receive more. The certification process is expensive and difficult to meet, and so it really has not added a lot of value. And it's not just for a trade, for organic coffee, for example. Ethiopia is the second largest producer of organic coffee in the world, second to Peru. But yet, certified organic coffee coming out of Ethiopia is probably less than 10% of the overall coffee. You know why? It's 100, almost 100% organic. The farmers can't afford to put chemicals, right? These are very poor farmers who live on, you know, less than $2 a day. They don't have the money to buy pesticide. Yet, you know, the process of getting certification is so expensive. You have to bring someone from Germany. They have local agents, but it's costly. And because of that, who benefits from that? You know, the people who are selling it up abroad know it's organic. They could trade it in certain ways because you grade it and you have the quality. But the farmers and the traders in country don't get that benefit. So that's a major problem in the marketplace.
I had a question about the educational system in Ethiopia, Mozambique, and Tanzania. With the economic growth, how's that affecting education?
Education is a major barrier and a problem in Africa in general. But some countries have done better than others. The former British colonies like Tanzania have a good basic primary education system, meaning up to the eighth grade, some to the secondary high school level, and a basic sort of level of university system. But access to tertiary education is limited, challenging. Some of the countries have invested a lot, like Mozambique and Ethiopia, and Nigeria is also in the process. Over the last 10 years, the last 20 years, Ethiopia has built 32 new universities. And, you know, from having 10,000 people graduating in a year from universities to like 500,000 people. Well, the problem is you have all these people graduating, then you have to find them jobs. And so that's the next challenge for Africans.
From the notes that I took, it says Africa has 60% of the world's uncultivated arable land. And then a little further down it says Africa's food import right now is $313 billion, expected to grow to $1 trillion by 2030. If they have so much arable land that's not being used, is there a push towards maybe cultivating some of that unused land?
Excellent question. I'll give you Nigeria. Right? Nigeria used to be a major agriculture exporting country up to the 1960s. What happened in the 1960s? Nigeria became independent. One. Two, they found oil. So, the combination of those two, self-governance challenge, you know, and lots of coups and corruption, and oil, right, diverted attention from the primary mode of living or the economy. Nigerians import about $12 billion worth of food every year. Right, even stuff that they used to export in the past. But now, you know, everybody knows oil is not going to last forever. Nigeria is another great example of democratization in Africa. They had a wonderful transition of democratic power last year, right? From an elected government to another elected government, different parties. First time in Nigeria's history. Their biggest curse is corruption. They're fighting corruption. They have a new president who's really committed to trying to resolve that. But the one really important thing is this problem is being resolved because it's a business opportunity. So you're seeing multinational agricultural investments going into Nigeria, Tanzania, and Mozambique for the domestic markets. If you have money, if you have the capacity to pay $12 billion to import basic agricultural foodstuff, right? Rice, maize, it's cheaper to grow locally than sell it and make money. So an increasing amount of investment is going in that direction. And I bet you, you know, if I speak here 10 years from now, there will still be imports. But it would probably be less than half of what is imported now.
Could you describe Zimbabwe for us a little bit and tell us what kind of a future you think? You know, especially, you know, once the old man dies, if Tsvangirai becomes leader, what kind of future the country holds?
All right, Zimbabwe is an interesting country, really a sad story. Like, in my work, what I do, like, for example, building commodity exchange, Zimbabwe had a thriving commodity exchange until the 1980s. Right? Now they're trying to build one, and we were actually contacted trying to help them, which is really sad. I mean, these were the guys who were leading the way. But they had problems, and part of the problem really deals with the leadership of the country. Part of the problem deals with the international community. I'm not willing to just leave the problem with the leadership of Mugabe. But they're going through this process now. They've stabilized the economy a little bit better than it was. I was in Zimbabwe in 2004. I was with 60 American lawyers, a bar association trip to Southern Africa. We drove from Botswana into Zimbabwe. And on the border, an immigration post, I saw a poster that I would never forget in my life. It said, "Please respect our currency, don't use it as a toilet paper." Right? People were like, you stand in line to buy bread, by the time you reach the pay, the price had like quadrupled. They had runaway inflation. But now they use dollar and euro as a currency, local currency. They made some and wrote some, changed, you know, some of the environment to allow foreign investors to come back. Some of the donors are going back to help. And the old man is 91 or 92 years old. He's probably gonna die. But what comes after is unknown. His own party is in the midst of power struggle. Whether the opposition is fractured as well, I don't know. Honestly, it's a crapshoot. No one knows what's going to happen. What everybody hopes is there'll be a smooth transition, whoever takes over. This is one of the things you sort of learn in this business and living and working in Africa is that you can't be a purist. And I like democracies, I like, you know, civil rights, and I want everything to be right. But you can't stop working because everything's not right, right? And one of the things I learned in the last couple of years is, well, sometimes stability is important over democracy. Like, look what happened in Syria. I'm not saying, you know, the Syrian government was an angel, it was great. But if I was a Syrian, I'm not speaking for anybody personally, if I was a Syrian, I would have preferred a brutal dictator than having, you know, 8 million people being destitute all over the world and dying in, you know, hunger and drowning in water. It really pushed in a very difficult sort of dichotomy and an ethical and moral challenge in bind. So what I hope for Zimbabwe is, I don't care who rules it, but I hope there'll be stability, there'll be peace, right? And they'll leave the people alone so they could go about their daily life. And I don't really care who rules it and who runs the country. That's the challenge we deal with in poor developing countries.
We got about 10 minutes left. You guys take advantage of this.
Just in general, I guess from a macro perspective, when you compare, for instance, with a country like India experiencing massive growth at a high level of GDP growth, they definitely benefit a lot from consumer services and crude oil refining, that kind of stuff. Obviously, they're still running on an old-age system, and at this point, consumer service systems. When you compare to an agrarian economy, such as a lot of the African ones we spoke about, can those countries experience the same speed of growth, or at least somewhat exponentially similar to what these other oil-based economies are experiencing in the long run?
That's a good question. My partner is Indian. We have an office in Indore, India. So I go to India once in a while. And our of my colleagues in India tell me, you know, Africa, most African countries remind them of India 30 years ago. When someone told me even the airport smelled like India, the airport 30 years ago, you know. There's a lot of similarities. But the pace might be faster. One good thing going for India is that India is the world's largest democracy. It's very stable. So that's very important. Stability is the most important ingredient for any economy. So that's been very important. But India is also an agrarian economy. It's really based on agriculture. And despite what you see about technology and everything, most Indians are engaged in agriculture. But the Green Revolution of the 1960s in India changed India forever. And Africa is going through that same process. In fact, one of the organizations we work with on a regular basis, funded by Gates, is called AGRA, Agriculture Revolution in Africa or something. And that is happening, but it's aided by the new technologies and the stuff that we have now at hand, as opposed to what India had 30 years ago to take from the world. So the pace is definitely accelerating, and not all African countries will have that opportunity, but I think a greater majority of them will take advantage of that opportunity. But what's really interesting for me is to see the South-South kind of investment opportunities going on. India has become now a donor country. That's why the British, for example, pulled out the DFID, their development agency for India. India grants money, provides technical assistance to African countries, so is Brazil, right? So is China. And that has been an interesting partnership because the Indians understand Africa better than the Western countries because their economies are closer. They may be 30 years apart in terms of development. So they're able to take advantage of the opportunities and also better to help African countries.
Either I
answered all your questions or I bored you to death, so one of the two.
Who would you say are the top three economies to look out for in Africa, next 5 years?
That's a hard one.
Well, you know, in your experience.
So, you know, like I said, I came from the Silicon Valley where there was a conference, and one of the PE investors, had this thing, they're investing in what he calls the king's countries, right? And these are the countries he said are to look for in the next 10 years. And I sort of agree with him to some degree. K stands for Kenya, I is for Ivory Coast, N for Nigeria, S for South Africa. It was Senegal, but changed it to South Africa. I would put Ethiopia in the middle of that, right? And part of it is I look out for basic investments in infrastructure, MDG goals, right? Building schools, making sure they have a well-educated workforce. So a lot of that is happening in all of these countries and in Ethiopia as well. And population, income growth, all of that is happening in these countries. But I think what is going to surprise most people is going to be countries like the DRC, Congo, people who are not really counting them in. Those are the countries to look for because they just need a little bit of stability.
What kind of future do you see for South Sudan in terms of growth?
Oh, I don't know. That's the biggest disappointment for me. Until they have stability, until they have a functioning government. Actually, I'm more optimistic with Somalia than South Sudan. Mm. Yeah, I had an amazing meeting with a company yesterday that's investing in Somalia. The stuff that's happening in Somalia is just unbelievable. Beyond the headlines, there's a lot of stuff happening in Somalia. And one part of it is because there's no government, really. So entrepreneurs are left to their devices. They're doing things. They they have better internet penetration than Ethiopia. You know, it's just really amazing. They have a banking sector. They have a mobiles. There's a company that's building their own off-grid power system. They're building their own grids. I mean, these are companies doing it.
They're building infrastructure without government.
Yeah, and they're making money. Yeah, I mean, they're, again, the biggest challenge is stability. Until they get the government really strengthened to a certain level and peace, there will be continuing challenges. South Sudan is just, I don't know how to describe it, it's really sad. They're warring factions. After so much struggle to be independent, they became independent. They have lots of resources, beautiful country, very fertile lands, but they can't get along ethnic lines. And that fight continues. About one third of the population is now in refugee camps back again, which is really sad. Part of it is, though, someone told me, you know, abused children grow up to be abusers. So the population that's in power, you know, were themselves abused during the 50 years of civil war and oppression by Northern Sudanese governments. And now, I'm not excusing them, but it's sort of the only logical way I could figure out or explain why they throw away something good after all that struggle and they have a government and, you know, because two guys don't get along and now, you know, millions of people are refugee camps.
We have to leave it at that, on that positive note. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. All right, you guys, so again, I want to thank Yohannes Assefa for coming here. You know, he's all the way from Washington, D.C., right? So we're very lucky to have him, and thanks again. For those of you who are in my class, what we'll do is, this is going to be your first assignment, and it'll be due in 1 week. You'll just upload it directly to Moodle. I'll create an area for you to upload it this afternoon. 2 pages summary of the presentation, and I'll post the video on Moodle within the next 24 hours.
Thank you.